It's the blue of the sky. It's the beacon in the night. It's the calm within the thunder and the rain. It's the end of all my shame. It's the love that knows my name. It's a peace beyond all understanding. It's the end and it's the start. Oh, it meets us where we are. It's the gravity that pulls us to your heart. It's the source of all our worth. It's the author of new birth. It's the genesis of all the universe.
Thank you, children. Thank you, Deb. Great. So these children learn these songs that we do about, I guess, every 5 or 6 weeks through their Sunday school class. So if you want your child or grandchild to participate, have them in Sunday school where they can learn our songs and be able to participate with the other children. Are we ready? Oh, I got one more coming. Let's all stand up for Jesus.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as Brother Donald reminded us this morning, how blessed and thankful we are that you awoke us. Father God, you let us get out of bed this morning. You let us get dressed by ourselves, Father. That is your grace and your mercy shining down, and we thank you for that, Father. Father God, as the Word of God is brought to us this morning, let us feed on this Word. Let us drink from the living water, not from the food and water of this world, Father, but your Scripture, Father, your truth. Father God, as Brother Chris stands before this congregation, Father, shield him, protect him, Father. Any scheme from the devil, any thought, any bad vibe, Father, I know that you will step in, you will intervene, you will block this, Father. And we thank you for the Word that he's going to bring today. As the tithes and offerings is given today, Father, let them be give by a giving heart, a thankful heart, Father, that only give back a portion that you have given to us. Father God, let you receive them, let you multiply them to be used in the furtherment of your kingdom. In the precious name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
You. It is so good to see you. We're glad. I walked in this morning, and we pray in the back before service each week, and as I walked by the baptistry, there wasn't any water in it, and I was a little discouraged by that. I kind of gotten used to baptizing folks, but come back next week, we'll have some more. And hey, listen, if you've not been baptized and you have trusted in Jesus as your Savior, you need to follow through with baptism. Amen. That is your first step of obedience to the Father. And so I want to encourage you, hey, if you've asked Jesus to save you and to forgive you of your sins, but you've not followed through with baptism, at the end of the service, you come forward and say, hey, I need to get baptized. Look, we've got young children that are leading the way. They're being examples for you as well. But if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, today is your day. God's working on your heart. God has placed you here on purpose for a reason to hear the gospel message, and he wants to save you. You just need to surrender your life to him. But visitors, we're glad you're here. Thank you for coming and visiting our church. If you got a copy of the bulletin, there is a portion there that you can fill out and give us some information about who you are and where you live. And so we would love just to reach out to you again and just tell you thank you for visiting our church. I'm challenging you this month. We've upped the ante a little bit with our memory verses. Last week we did two verses, or last month. This month we're doing three verses, and they come out of 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1 through 3. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the Word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. How many of you this morning have tasted the grace of God? Amen. If you've tasted the grace of God, if you've been saved, if you've been changed by the blood of Jesus, the Holy Bible tells us that we are to grow. Amen. To desire the pure milk of the Word, that we may grow. God doesn't want you to stay how you were. Amen. He wants you to grow. And his word tells us. So we welcome you here. Let's pray and let's continue in a spirit of worship this morning. God, we're thankful that you love us. We're thankful that we can taste the graciousness that you've offered us. Lord, we're thankful that you gave us something that we could not earn, that we did not deserve, in your magnificent love. God, I pray that if there's somebody here that needs to feel that love today, maybe they're broken, maybe they're burdened, God, I pray that they would feel your love in a special way like they never have before, God. Lord, I pray that your Spirit would move through this place. I pray that you'd move through our hearts. I pray that you would guide us into the life that you would have us to live, Lord, that you would encourage us, that you would challenge us to go out and to share this gospel message, Lord, that changes lives. God, minister to us in this place, Lord, and most of all, may you be magnified. May you be lifted up. May you be glorified today. And in the precious name of Jesus, we pray it all. Amen.
Amen. You know, through his amazing grace, we're able to be here today. He saved our soul. He gave me all these beautiful singers and musicians. And I want us all to stand and give him praise this morning. This is amazing grace. Is in Jesus.
the Savior, and I felt far from above. And I've been down to the river, yes, I have.
Kids to leave yet. We got something special this morning. So y'all just hang tight for just a few minutes. We're going to play a video and then we'll talk about it a little bit more.
We know it because he said it.
Jesus said, "The world will see him when the world sees us."
That's why together we do this.
We give so that those who've not yet seen can see.
It means something when the world sees how we give.
It means something because we do not look the same.
It means something because we do not sound the same.
It means something because when we give, this is what the world sees.
They see the gospel doing what the world cannot.
They see the gospel making us one. And so we give.
We give so that missionaries can go.
We give so that churches can be started, hurts can be healed, and truth can be shared.
We give so the world might see Jesus in us.
United as one.
And as we approach the Easter season, we want to again give you an opportunity to sow seed of the gospel. And so we do that at Christmas time through Lottie Moon. We do that at Easter through the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. Lottie Moon is International Mission Board that goes worldwide. Annie Armstrong is North American Mission Board. And so this is a missions offering, and I've talked multiple times about we need to be a missional church. Amen. We need to be the hands and feet of Jesus. We need to be physically going out being missional, but we can also do so through financial giving. And so we're going to give you the next month to give towards the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. But we don't want you just to give financially. We've also included the week of prayer for the Annie Armstrong offering. I would encourage you, this was in your bulletin. If you didn't get a copy of the bulletin, get one and make sure that you get one of these prayer guides for this week and pray for these specific missionaries that are on the field today as we speak, sharing the gospel. And so we want to really emphasize this over the next month. We've set a goal of $10,000. I know you can do it. I know you can do it. And so let's do that. And so children, we're fixing to have our missions march to open up our Annie Armstrong Easter offering giving. And so you're going to play a little song for us on that organ. And doesn't it sound good to have the organ back? Amen. So we'll start our missions march. So if you've got money that you'd like to give to our missions offering, there are baskets on the front, and we want to invite you to come and put it in this morning. Amen. Onward, Christian soldiers. That sounded so good. Thank you for that. So say this with me this morning. Give me understanding, and I shall keep your law. Indeed, I shall observe it with my whole heart. Amen. Children, you can be released for children's worship this morning. Ezra chapter number 5. Ezra chapter number 5. We want to speak on the subject of standing up for the way of the Lord this morning. We want to stand up for the way of the Lord, for the way of God. That's how we want to stand. Now, Katie and I, we like to travel. Anybody else like to travel and go see the world? We like to travel. Now, I'm just going to be honest with you. We don't get to do it nearly as much as we would like to, but we like to go new places. We like to see new things. And when we travel, we get on our Google Maps and we look at what way we're going to go. We need it to calculate which way is the fastest route possible. You know, usually when you put in an address, it'll give you the fastest route, and then it'll give you the shortest route, and it'll give you, this is the route with no tolls, or if you want to take the route with tolls, it gives you all of these options. But can I tell you that when you are traveling with 3 children under 9, you had better pick the fastest route. Amen? You need the fastest route when you're doing that. And so when we travel, we're looking for the quickest way possible to go. That is the way for us, the path of least resistance. That's what we want. We want to avoid red lights. We want to avoid congested areas, all of that. We got to get there because you just know. In our everyday life, though, we're going somewhere. Whether we're traveling or whether we're just living life, we're always in the car. Home is not a place that we spend a lot of time at, and we're always traveling. And so for us, when we travel to try to save time, we want to make sure that we're going the right way, the quickest way. As we get to chapter 5 in Ezra, we see a continuation of our theme, if you were with us last week, from chapter 4 of opposition. Some of those roadblocks, so to speak, things that would kind of slow the way down. And we can see, based on other parts of Scripture, that the work on the temple, the whole reason that they went back to Jerusalem, the work on the temple had ceased. It had stopped. They were no longer working. And if you remember, because this was a problem. This was a big, big problem. That was the whole purpose. God sent the people back to Jerusalem. They were ordered by God. God had chosen this group of people to go back and to rebuild the temple, and they were not doing what he had told them to do. They were not going the way of the Lord. They had totally left the direction that he wanted them to follow. And then what was happening, they were allowing the resistance that we looked at last week, they were allowing that resistance to keep them from going the right way. The best way, the way that God had ordained for them. And so today, we want to see that the Lord has a way for us to go as well. God has a will for our lives. He has a path for our lives that he wants us to travel. He wants us to live by. And there's sometimes when we look at the way that God wants us to go, we understand that we have options. You have free will. You can decide whether you're going to go that way or you're not going to go that way. The people in Jerusalem, they chose not to go the way that the Lord wanted them to go. And sometimes when that free will kicks in, when there's a way for us to go, a lot of times we choose the easy way. The way that doesn't require any faith, the way that doesn't require any prayer. We take this way anytime we see opposition, anytime we see some inconvenience, that's the way that we choose. And oftentimes we need to understand that the easy way, the convenient way, doesn't always necessarily line up with God's way. It's not necessarily the way God wants you to go just because it's easy. And when we take the easy way, we end up not going where God wants us to go and not doing what God has called us to do. And we don't reach our destination of God's will. There's our own way. You know, we take the easy way sometimes. Then sometimes we take our own way where we don't consult the Lord at all. We're not interested in what God wants us to do. We're not looking for what God wants us to do because all we want to do is our own thing, what our heart leads us to do, what our feelings lead us to do. And most of you probably know from experience that when we go our own way, it oftentimes always leads in the wrong way. Amen? Our own way is often the wrong way. And we have no chance of following God's path when we're making our own way, when we're creating our own path. But then there's God's way. Right? We got the easy way. We got our own way. But then there's God's way. And when we follow this path for our lives, then many of us probably know that life is so much better. Even when life is difficult, it's so much better when you're in the will of God. Amen? When life is inconvenient, when life is hard, when you know you're in the center of the will, you still have a peace. You still have a comfort. There's still satisfaction in your life because God has put it there because you are in the center of his will. And not only do we need to go in the way that God has planned for us, but today we want to look at that we need to stand up for that way. We need to stand up for the way that God has put for us. We need to make sure that we are living it and proclaiming it and defending it and fighting for it. How many of you fight for the way of the Lord? How many of you defend the way of the Lord? We've got to live in it and we've got to live for it. And in chapter 5, the people had a choice to make. They had a choice to make either continue to take the path of least resistance and continue to be out of the will of God, to continue to reject what God wanted them to do, to continue to neglect building the temple, or they could choose to faithfully carry out God's plan, stand up for God's plan, and stand against anybody who opposed that plan. And they could get the job done. And so let's read chapter 5 this morning, and let's see what they did. Ezra chapter 5, starting in verse number 1, then the prophet Haggai, and Zechariah, the son of Iddo. Prophets prophesied to the Jews who were in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of the God of Israel who was over them. So Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Jeshua, the son of Jozadak, rose up and began to build the house of God, which is in Jerusalem. And the prophets of God were with them, helping them. At the same time, Tattenai, the governor of the region beyond the river of Shethar-Boznai, and their companions came to them and spoke thus to them, "Who has commanded you to build this temple and finish this wall?" Then, accordingly, we told them the names of the men who were constructing this building. I find it interesting. They told them their real names, by the way. They made sure that they knew, yeah, this is us. You report back, I'm the one that's rebuilding the temple. They had a boldness, a newfound boldness here. But verse 5, but the eye of their God was upon the elders of the Jews so that they could not make them cease till a report could go to Darius. Then a written answer was returned concerning this matter. This is a copy of the letter that Tattenai sent. The governor of the region beyond the river of Shethar-Boznai and his companions, the Persians who were in the region beyond the river to Darius the king. They sent a letter to him in which was written thus, to Darius the king, all peace. Let it be known to the king that we went into the province of Judea to the temple of the great God, which is being built with heavy stones and timber, is being laid in the walls, and this work goes on diligently and prospers in their hands. Then we asked those elders and spoke thus to them, who commanded you to build this temple and to finish these walls? We also asked them their names to inform you that we might write the names of the men who were chief among them. And thus they returned us an answer saying, I love this. We are the servants of the God of heaven and earth, and we are rebuilding the temple that was built many years ago, which a great king of Israel built and completed. But because our fathers provoked the God of heaven to wrath, he gave them into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, the Chaldean, who destroyed this temple and carried the people away to Babylon. However, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Babylon, King Cyrus issued a decree to build this house of God. Also, the gold and silver articles of the house of God, which Nebuchadnezzar had taken from the temple that was in Jerusalem and carried into the temple of Babylon, those King Cyrus took from the temple of Babylon, and they were given to one named Sheshbazzar, whom he had made governor. And he said to him, take these articles, go, carry them to the temple site that is in Jerusalem, and let the house of God be rebuilt on its former site. Then the same Sheshbazzar came and laid the foundation of the house of God, which is in Jerusalem. But from that time, even until now, it has been under construction and is not finished. Now, therefore, if it seems good to the king, let a search be made in the king's treasure house, which is there in Babylon, whether it is so that a decree was issued by King Cyrus to build this house of the God of Jerusalem, and let the king send us his pleasure concerning this matter. God, we're grateful for this response. We're grateful of how you spoke to this people. You reminded them of your way for their life and what you wanted them to do, Lord, and they humbly submitted and carried on your work. And God, I pray that as we look at this text a little deeper this morning, God, that we would examine our own hearts to make sure that we are not only going in the way of the Lord, that we're standing in the way of the Lord, and that we're standing up for the way of the Lord in our lives. Lord, speak to us through your word, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to share a couple of things this morning that have to happen for us to both stay on the way that the Lord has for us and to stand up for the way that the Lord has for our lives and in this world. And so number one, what we need is we need a people to tell it how it is. We need people to tell it how it is. We see this in verse number one. And verse number one is critical to what is happening in the rest of the chapter here in Ezra chapter 5. Read it with me again. Then the prophet Haggai and Zechariah, the son of Iddo, prophets, prophesied to the Jews who were in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of the God of Israel who was with them. Now we see Haggai and Zechariah. And they were active. They were prophetic during the time of the rebuild of Jerusalem. Now, we read verse 1, but verse 1 doesn't really give us any context as to what Haggai and Zechariah said to the people. And so we got to do a little digging. And so I want to bring your attention to Haggai chapter 1. Haggai is a hard book to find, so I put it on the screen for you. You don't have to flip and find it. But Haggai chapter number 1, starting in verse 3, says this, then the word of the Lord came by Haggai, the prophet, saying, is it time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses and this temple to lie in ruins. Now, therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but do not have enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put into a bag with holes. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the mountains and bring wood and build the temple that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified, says the Lord. That was Haggai's message that we read about here in Ezra chapter 5, verse 1. Now, what about Zechariah's message? Now, Zechariah's message, it was more of a spiritual message. Zechariah chapter 1, verse 3 says, thus says the Lord of hosts, return to me. Thus says the Lord of hosts, return to me, says the Lord of hosts, and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. Well, what we have is a people that had been completely inactive in carrying out God's plan for rebuilding the temple for really about 16 years. So we saw in Ezra chapter number 4 that they stopped the work and that they continued not to work for about 16 years. The opposition that they had faced had gotten them off track, and they said, you know what, we're not going to rock the boat. You know, they came and stopped us, and we're not going to speak out against that. We're going to take the easy way. We're going to take the comfortable way. And to me, that sounds much like the North American church today. The Western church, we're going to take the easy route. If somebody tells us to stop, or somebody tells us that the gospel is offensive, or if that it bothers them and they don't want to hear it, then we're just going to back off. We take the path of least resistance. And so God, in Ezra chapter 5, he sent some messengers to get his people's attention because they were taking the path of least resistance. Now Haggai, he was very direct. He was very to the point. You know what his message was? Get back to work. God has given you a job, and you need to get back to work doing the job. He says, and look, just examine your lives for a minute. He says, you're living in your paneled houses. You're living the comfortable life right now with no opposition while the temple remains in ruins. He says, and just examine your life for just a second. You're doing all of these things, but there's no satisfaction. He says, consider your ways. You've sown much and bring in little. You eat, but do not have enough. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. You earn wages to put them in a bag with holes. In other words, your life is empty. You may feel safe, and you may feel comfortable, but there's an emptiness there. There's a void in your life because you're not in the will of God. You're not doing what God wanted you to do. And in our lives, when we're not in the will of God, there's going to be an emptiness there. There's going to be a void. There's going to be something missing. Well, Zechariah, he was a little different in his approach. He says, you need to get your heart right. Haggai says, get back to work. And Zechariah says, you need to get your heart right. You need to seek the Lord. You need to feel that emptiness that's in your life, that emptiness that my brother Haggai has told you about. You need to fill that with more of God. You need to seek him. And so what we see are two different ways to share the same message. Haggai and Zechariah's message was the same. Get back to work. Do the Lord's will. The people had to reengage in what God had called them to do. When we're talking about staying on the Lord's path, we need to see the value of having people in our lives that are going to call it like they see it. Zechariah and Haggai, they called it like they saw it. And they spoke, and we call that accountability. We call that accountability. We need people to hold us accountable among the body of Christ. Now, praise God that he sent these warnings to the people of Jerusalem, because you know what they did? We read it. They started building. They got back to work. That's the God that we serve, though. You see, for 16 years, they had laid the work down, and they had allowed the opposition to stop them. But we see in his message through Haggai and his message that he sent through Zechariah that we serve a God who is patient. I am so grateful for the patience of God this morning. We serve a God who's patient, who gives us chance after chance after chance to get it right, to get back on his path. You know, think of it like an interstate. A lot of times there are some interstate exits where it's exit only, right? Thank God that we don't serve a God that when we exit off of his path, that there's not a reentry point. Amen. God will allow you to get back on the way at any point you decide, you know what? This is leaving me empty. I'm earning wages for a bag that has holes in it. I need to get back on God's path. And you know what God's going to do? He said, come on back. Come on back and get on my way and let's do this. But we see a God who is patient, whose chief desire was for his people to be right so that they could have a close relationship with him, so that they could enjoy the fullness of the blessing that God wanted to bestow upon them and their people. And so God had clearly laid out what he wanted his people to accomplish. There's no question that. Just as God has clearly laid out the way that he wants us to go in his word. You say, well, I don't know what God wants me to do. Just read the word of God. It will describe for you how God wants you to live and what God wants you to do. Now, and we all know, sometimes we get off track. There are days when we get off track, when we're not where we need to be. There are times we're not living in the way that God desires for us to live. And in those moments, when we do get off track, we need people in our lives that we can depend on, that we can trust in, that will say, hey, you're taking a detour. And that detour is not going to be good for you. Get back on the right way. We need that accountability. We need it individually. We need personal accountability. People that are willing to tell us how it is. We need pastors who unapologetically call sin, sin, and wickedness, wickedness, and warn the church of the dangers of being out of the will of God. We need people in our lives that have a backbone to share God's plan and God's will. But too many churches have become these feel-good self-help shops. That's what a lot of churches are today. Places that where we go and we hear a motivational speech. Now we need people. I'd say this, and you've probably already tired of hearing about it. But if sin is not mentioned in a church, you need to find a new church, because it's mentioned in the Bible. Now, yeah, yes, we need to talk about God's love, and we need to talk about God's mercy, and we need to talk about God's patience, and we need to talk about God's forgiveness and his grace and all those things. But we got to stick to the whole counsel of the Word of God. Amen. But we don't just need this in the church. We need this in society. We need Christians to stand up for the way of the Lord. It is so clear that our nation and most of the world is not following the way of the Lord. And we shouldn't expect them to if they're not followers of Christ, right? We shouldn't be surprised. Just this week, I read an article just a couple of days ago. It was so disturbing to me. But a school board member in Arizona, some of you may have read this, wanted to end a partnership that the school district had with a Christian college, a local Christian college. And this Christian college, anybody that was going through their education program, they had partnered with this school district to send in their student teachers. Right, so they're going to go do their student teaching at the school district, and they had this partnership where they were working together, and this school board member stepped up and said, you know what, I think we need to end this partnership with this Christian university, because what we have, there's no room there's no room in the public school for teachers who have been trained under a biblical worldview. Now, I want you to think about that for just a second. That's in the United States of America. If you've been trained under the teaching of Jesus Christ, then there is no room for you in the public school system. And her argument was that anyone from this college, and because this is the hot topic, anybody from this college would make public school unsafe for anybody in the LGBTQ community. Unsafe. That was her word, unsafe. Because they follow the teachings of Jesus Christ. We need a backbone, amen. We need to stand up for the Word of God. We live in a society that is trying to redefine everything that God has already set in order. That God has already said, this is how it is. God is the one that sets the standards, and it is not for us to change them. It is us to abide by them, to live by them, to faithfully proclaim the Word of the Lord. And first and foremost, we do that by living according to the Word. We need preachers and Christian leaders and followers of Christ that are going to defend what the Lord says, that are going to stand up for the way of God. Now, where we miss the boat is we don't proclaim this message in a compassionate, loving, and gentle way. But we should be clear about it. We should be clear about the way of the Lord. And when we stand, we better make sure that we're not standing, because we like to do this, amen. We like to put our little soapbox up there, and we get on our soapbox, and we talk about our soapbox. We need to be standing squarely on the Word of God. What does God's Word say? Therefore, that's what I believe. And that's what I'm going to defend. There's a point for this whole point, by the way, is for the church. This is for believers, for God's people. Zechariah and Haggai, they weren't going and prophesying to the lost people here. They were going and prophesying to God's people that God had sent to do His work. This message is for the church this morning. We've got to stand up for the Word of God in the church. Too many churches are going the way of the world, because we don't stand on biblical truth. Number two, not only do we need people to tell it how it is, we need to hear it for how it is. Look at verse 2. Verse 2 says, "So Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Jeshua, the son of Jozadak," what did they do? "They rose up and began to build the house of God, which is in Jerusalem, and the prophets of God were with them, helping him." And I love that part too. That tells me that Zechariah and Haggai, they weren't there just to proclaim the message. They said, "We want to get our hands dirty too." You know, a lot of times we can be all talk and no effort. We got to be talk and effort, amen? We got to put our money where our mouth is, and the prophets did that. But we see that these people, they took the warnings from Zechariah and Haggai to heart. And so what we get from that is, when there's somebody in our lives that is trying to hold us accountable to God's standard, to God's Word, we too need to take those words to heart. Instead, so many times when somebody tries to hold us accountable, it's like, "You don't even know me. You don't judge me. You worry about your own problems. I've got my problems, and let me deal with them." No. When a loving brother or sister in Christ gently and compassionately and lovingly comes to you and says, "Hey, I love you too much to not say anything," then we need to take that to heart. Now, yes, we've all got our problems. But and when I'm talking about accountability, you need somebody that you can trust and depend on, that you know loves you and that you love. I love the transition, though, that we see here in verse 2. They rose up and began to build. You know what that means? They received the Word of God. They didn't just hear the Word of God. They received the Word of God in their hearts. So much so that they allowed it to manifest itself out of their lives. They didn't argue with God. When Zechariah and Haggai said, "Get back to work," they said, but look at all the people that are threatening us. They're going to throw us. They're going to kill us. They're going to throw us in jail. Look at all the opposition that we're facing." No, they didn't make excuses. It simply says that they rose up and they built. They got back to work. They heard the message loud and clear, and they responded. And when we hear the message of God's Word, we need to respond to it. We don't need to argue with it. We don't need to wrestle with it. We need to obediently follow what God's Word says and where He wants us to go. And if that message for us is to remain in the way of the Lord, if that's being proclaimed clearly, then it would do us well to follow that message, to hear it, and to live it. So often, though, we don't want to hear things for how they are in our life, right? None of us like to hear that we've gone down the wrong path, even though sometimes we know ourselves we're going down the wrong path. We don't want somebody else telling us that. You know, we don't want somebody pouring salt in that wound, so to speak. You know, it's real easy. It's real easy for us to talk about what's going on around the world, and we all agree about the world's sinfulness, and we all agree about other people's sinfulness, but what about our own? We don't like to hear about that. We don't like to have those discussions. We don't like to hear that what we're doing, or in this case, what they weren't doing, because... Ooh. Huh. You know, I think the biggest problem in the church so much is probably not the sins of commission, but the sins of omission, what we're not doing. That was the case here. It's what they were not doing. That was the problem. But we don't like to hear that. We don't like to hear that. Why? Because it stings. It's convicting. None of us enjoy conviction. But all of us should be grateful for conviction. Amen? Because without conviction, we'd never get back on the right way. We'd never be on the right way without the conviction. But it hurts to be told that we're missing the mark. Accountability is a difficult thing to receive. We've got to have this mindset. When somebody is trying to hold us accountable, we need to make sure that we're not receiving it as criticism or as judgment. And a lot of times the reason that we receive it as criticism, as judgment, because that's how the person that's trying to hold us accountable brings it to us. So be careful there. Be careful in how you approach trying to hold someone accountable, but we need to receive it with gladness. Receive it with thanksgiving in our hearts. Too often we say, who are you to judge me? And instead of saying, you know what? Yeah, I don't really like them bringing that up, but maybe God is trying to get my attention about something. Maybe God is trying to show me something in my life that needs to change. Have we ever considered that God may be sending that person, that God himself may have sent that person to you to bring up whatever it is in your life that person's brought up, just as he sent Haggai and Zechariah? Proverbs chapter 27, verse 17. As iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. We're here for each other, amen? We're here to encourage one another and to assist one another. And listen, if you've ever been offended when a preacher preached on sin because maybe you hit a little too close to home, and instead of being upset with that preacher, maybe it's time to take a good hard look in the mirror. And can I say this? There's too many of you for me to know everything that's going on in your life. I'm not going around trying to get the gossip on every church member so that I can know what to preach on Sunday. That's why I like preaching books of the Bible, because, hey, wherever God has put us that day and however it speaks to you, then that's got to be of God. That can't be me, amen. We got to take it as a warning from the Lord, though, when he speaks to us in this way. We need to hear the word of the Lord, and then we need to obey the word of the Lord. And so what is God telling you right now? What is God speaking in your life right now? Is there something that God wants you to do that you haven't been doing? Is there something that God wants you to stop doing that you have been doing? Maybe you've known for a long time what God wants you to do, but for whatever reason, you haven't been doing it. Maybe you're involved in something that he wants you to quit doing, and you just haven't found the strength and the power or the reliance, really, on the Holy Spirit to be able to quit. Whatever God is saying to us, we need to receive it. We need to hear it. We need to respond to it, just as the people in Jerusalem responded. And we don't need to get offended. We don't need to get defensive. We don't need to try to justify or excuse what we're doing. We just need to truly hear what God is trying to say to us and respond to it in obedience. And then number three this morning, not only do we need people to tell it like it is, and not only do we need to hear it like it is, we need to trust it for what it is. We need to trust it for what it is. After we see that God and we see that God's intended way for the people was reiterated, and after we see that they responded by resuming the work on the temple, we then see a wonderful truth about living in obedience to the will of God, to the word of God. We've already made mention in verse 2 how the prophets were with them and they were helping him, but look at verse 5. In verse 5 it says, "But the eye of their God was upon the elders of the Jews, so that they could not make them cease." And isn't that good? The whole world wanted to come against this work on the temple. But because the people were in the will of God, because they were following God's plan for their life, the supernatural power of a holy God could not let it stop. It was impossible to stop that work. You know why? Not because of the strength of the individuals, but because of the strength of God. The strength of the Lord made it to where this work was going to resume come what may. Nothing was going to stop it. And when we're doing what God wants us to do, when we're following God's plan and God's will, when we're being obedient to His word, His eye is upon you, which means you have God's full support. And not only do you have God's full support, you've got all of God's power behind you. And let me just remind you, that power of God is what created you and everything around us. Amen. That's the kind of power that you have helping you stay in His will, in His way, and doing His work. We've got the help that we need. God equips us to do whatever it is that He desires for us to do. He equipped the people of Jerusalem to rebuild the temple. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. God's going to make sure that you can get it done. He's going to provide for you the tools necessary to do what He's called you to do. And then we get to verse 11. And this is my favorite verse in the whole chapter. Read this with me. And thus they returned us an answer, saying, y'all, this is boldness. This is courage. This is, I don't care what you're telling me to do. I know what God has told me to do, and so you can go kick rocks. That's what verse 11 is. We are the servants of the God of heaven and earth, and we are rebuilding the temple that was built many years ago, which a great king of Israel built and completed. We don't care what you're telling us to do. We don't care that you don't want us to build the temple. God wants us to build the temple, and we're serving Him, and we're living for Him, and we're going to build the temple. So get out of the way. A newfound boldness, a newfound confidence that they had because of what it says in verse 5, because the eye of their God was upon the elders. They knew God was with them. You see, in chapter 4, when they stepped back from the work, they had kind of lost sight that this was God's plan. They had lost sight that God was with them and that God was in this, and so they quit. For 16 years, they laid it down. But when God reminded them that He was there through the prophets of Zechariah and Haggai, they said, hey, let's get back to work. God's still here. God's still involved in this. This is what God wants for us. And all this does is emphasize that we need to trust. We need to trust in the way of the Lord, that it is the right way for us. We need to recognize that God's will, God's plan is truly the best way for us. It's the way that we need to go. And we need to trust that God's plan for us is for good. You see, for them, it was really hard to trust that God's plan for them was for good at first because all they could see were the threats. All they could see was the opposition. All they could see were the possible negative outcomes that might come from that. And don't we do that same thing? When we're faced with something, our mind automatically starts to go to the worst possible outcome. Does it not? This is the worst that could happen, and surely, based on my luck and based on Murphy's Law, that's what's going to happen to me. I'm going to face the worst possible outcome. We need to trust the Lord, though. And when we're in His way and in His plan, no matter what obstacles or pitfalls come along the way, then we can know that His plan is good, and it will be accomplished. But we need to view those words of correction, those warnings that we get from other brothers and sisters, those challenges to say, hey, get plugged in, get involved, get to work. We need to view that as a wonderful blessing from God, and we need to trust in it. All God is doing, and all God was doing right here was to get us back on, to get them back on track. And that's all He's wanting to do for you. He wants to get you back in His will. Why? Because His will is best. We mess it up. When we do our will, when we go our way, we find ourselves, I like to say this, in the ditch all so often. If you're in God's will, you'll never find yourself in a ditch. It may be hard, but there'll be peace. There'll be gratification. There'll be satisfaction that you can't experience otherwise. He just wants to get you back on track because He desires what's best for us. He doesn't want us to miss out because of our tendency to disobey or to lack trust. We need to trust the Lord. And in verse 11, they made a proclamation. Can you make a proclamation this morning? If you know God wants you involved, and he wants all of us involved, by the way. The Great Commission, first and foremost, was for all of us. And if you know that that's what God wants you to do, is to go and to make disciples, then you need to make a proclamation this morning, because there's opposition. There are obstacles. There are people that are standing in the way of sharing the gospel, of sharing the love of Jesus, who don't want anything to do with it. Make the proclamation that they made in verse number 11. I'm a servant of the God of heaven. Say that with me. I am a servant of the God of heaven. Say that. I'll get you organized here in a minute. I am a servant of the God of heaven. Amen. Don't ever forget that. Don't ever forget that that's who you serve. I'm a servant of the God of heaven and earth, and we are rebuilding this temple. And instead of saying rebuilding this temple, I'm working for the kingdom of God. I'm a servant of the God of heaven and earth, and I'm serving him. I'm trying to do my part in building the kingdom of God. Now, you can't save a soul. But we talked about it in Sunday school this morning. You can't convict somebody of their sin. That's not your job. But you can tell them about the love of Jesus. You can show them that when their life is empty, as Haggai said, you know, when they're striving and striving and striving and there's nothing but emptiness, they're earning wages to go into a bag with holes. Any of you have a hole in your pocket before and the money fall out? We did Christmas a few months ago, the Polar Express. You know, he got the bell from Santa Claus, and he had the hole in his pocket, and it fell out. How discouraging that was. That's how life is when we strive and strive and strive and strive the wrong direction. It leads to discouragement. It leads to brokenness. It leads to hurt, to dissatisfaction. But when we're in the will of God, there's fullness. There's fullness in the way of the Lord. Haggai and Zechariah's message was clear. Their messages were in agreement. They said the same thing. Their messages that came directly from the Lord, and their messages that they needed to proclaim. The people's hearts needed to hear their messages, and they needed to apply their messages so that they could get back on God's path for their life. And God was proving once again how he could be trusted. He was showing them again that they could trust him. And in this case, in Ezra chapter 5, the people chose the way of the Lord. They chose his way. They didn't choose their way. They didn't choose the world's way. The world's way was for them to stop and to not do anything for the Lord, just as the world would tell the church, you need to stop. You need to quit with this Jesus stuff. But they said, no. We're servants of the God of heaven and earth. And we're rebuilding this temple. You're a servant of God. Do the word of God. Be a doer of the word of God. Don't just hear it this morning. Do the word of God. God has shown us in his word what he desires for us to do, who he desires us to be. And so this morning, again, if you're unsure about what God has for your life, I would encourage you to start in here. Start in his word. What does his word say about my life? Seek his will for your life in scripture. He shows us in scripture how we ought to live. He shows us in scripture how we ought to act. His word outlines what honors him and what dishonors him. And that's what we need to be standing on. And again, we're quick to be upset and bothered when the world's not living according to God's standard. When they aren't living in a biblical way, we're quick to stand up for others' wrongdoings, but what about our own wrongdoings? Does it bother us when we realize that we're not measuring up in something that God's word clearly speaks on? If we're going to stand on the way of the Lord, then we got to focus on our own lives. And so this morning, let this be about you and the Lord. God, am I walking in the on the path that, that you have for me? Am I doing your will in my life? Is my life honoring and pleasing you? Is my life magnifying you? Or God, have I taken a detour? Have I gotten off that path? And if you realize this morning that you're not on the path that God wants you to be, just like I said, there's always an on-ramp to get back on. And today can be the day that you get back on that path, if you will respond. If you'll make excuses, then you won't get back on that path. If you'll justify, then you won't get back on that path. You've got to surrender. You've got to respond to God's word. Father, we pray this morning, thankful that you have laid out your will for our lives, that you've shown us who you want us to be, that you've shown us how you want us to live, what you want us to do. And God, I pray for each and every one of us here this morning, God, Lord, that we would be centered in your will. God, I pray that you would help us, Lord, if we've gotten off track, because we do. So often we get off track, God, but if that's the case this morning, God, I pray that you will reveal that to us. And Lord, not only will you reveal it to us, but that we would respond to it, just as the people here in Jerusalem did. And they got back to doing your will. God, I pray that if there's someone here, Lord, that they've never walked in your way, or that they don't know anything about your will, that they've lived trying to satisfy their needs in their own strength and their own power and have found nothing but emptiness and brokenness and hurt and discouragement. God, it could be that they simply don't know you as Savior, Lord, that they don't have a relationship with you. They have not tasted the living water. God, I pray that if there's someone here today that needs to call out to you for salvation, that needs their sins forgiven, Lord, and they want to experience peace, and they want to experience the fullness and the goodness of life that you have offered. God, I pray that they would surrender and call on you for salvation today. God, I pray, as we mentioned earlier, if there's someone here, Lord, that's done that, Lord, they've trusted in you for salvation, Lord, but they've not obeyed you in following through with baptism. God, Lord, I pray that you would give them the courage to come and say, Lord, I want to proclaim to the rest of the world that I'm following Jesus. I want to be baptized. God, I pray that you'd give them the courage to come forth and do that. Lord, I pray that if there's somebody here that says, you know what, I see that God is moving in this church, in this body of believers, and I'm not affiliated with a church, and I want that accountability of a church family to help hold me to God's standard. I want to be a part of this church. I want to serve God here. I want people to encourage me and to help me in my walk. If God's leading you to be a part of our church family, we want to invite you. But God, I pray, whatever the case may be in the hearts of your people this morning, God, I pray that we would respond. I pray that we wouldn't sit idly by and wait till we come back next week and maybe we'll respond then. Lord, we may not get next week. Today is the day. Now is the time. Your message has been spoken, and it needs to be responded to. God, move in these next few minutes, we pray in Jesus' name.